Hello everyone, this is the history tutorial video for class 7. We were doing the chapter the Delhi Sultanate. We will continue with the consolidation of the kingdom, the consolidation of Delhi Sultanate. Now the consolidation of a kingdom as vast as the Delhi Sultanate, as large as the Sultanate, it needed reliable governors, reliable officers to hold important posts in the government, to govern important provinces which were too far away from Delhi, too far away from the capital for the Sultan to rule himself. Now, the early Delhi Sultans, especially Iltutmish, favored their special slaves purchased for military services called Bandagan in Persian. So, especially Iltutmish, the second Sultan of the Delhi Sultanate, he and many other sultans of the early days of the Delhi Sultanate, they preferred slaves. Slaves were specially bought from the slave market, and they were specially trained by these sultans to hold important offices. Some of the most important political offices in the kingdom were held by slaves. They were called Bandagan in Persian. It's a Persian word. Since these slaves were totally dependent upon their master, the Sultan could trust and rely upon them. Some scholars have even said that slaves were more trustworthy than own children of the Sultans. Why is that? Because you see, the Sultan's children, the Sultan's sons, they had ambitions of becoming the next Sultan. They had ambitions to get the throne for themselves. So they also can possibly harbor the feeling that in order to achieve the throne, in order to become the Sultan, they had to kill their fathers. Now that would be dangerous for the Sultan, as his life was put in danger by his own sons. So that's why the sons were not so trustworthy for the sultans. But because a slave was dependent upon the sultan, because the sultan was his master, and a slave cannot function or cannot hold important offices without its master, so that's why there was no danger from the slave. At least the slave won't harm him in any way or would try to kill him, because the slave had no ambition without his master. So that's why slaves were more trustworthy than the Sultan's own sons. Now the Khiljis and the Tughlaqs, they continued to use Bandagan and also raised people of humble birth, of poor background, who were often their clients. So the Khilji Sultans and the Tughlaq Sultans, they continued to use the slaves, and also they continued to patronize people who are of humble background and raise them to important positions. They were appointed as generals and governors. However, this also introduced an element of political instability. How? Slaves and clients were loyal to their masters and patrons, but not to the children of those. Now, if a sultan dies, then the slaves and the clients, the new people of humble birth who were given important offices by the sultan, they clashed with the new sultan, because new sultan had new slaves, new sultan had new clients. So the old slaves and old clients, they clashed with the new servants. As a result, the accession of a new monarch often saw conflict between the old and the new nobility. The patronage of these humble people by the Delhi Sultans also shocked many elites. And the authors of Persian history, the authors of Persian Tawarikh, they criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low-born to high offices, since that was a society of people who believed that birth is very important. in which background you are being born, in which family you are being born, that alone can decide what work you do. But the sultans did not believe in all those. The sultans often raised low-born people to high offices. This also invited criticism from the writers of history, who criticized the sultans for appointing low-born people to high offices. For example, Sultan Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he appointed Aziz Khumar, a wine distiller, a winemaker, Firuz Hajjam, a barber, Manka Tabak, a cook, and two gardeners, Ladha and Pira. He raised these people to important administrative posts. Now, the history writer of his time, Ziauddin Barani, reported the appointments as a sign of Sultan's loss of political judgment and his incapacity to rule. So, this historian, Barani, he criticized Muhammad bin Tughlaq because he appointed low-born as high officials. So, he criticized the Sultan as losing the political judgment and the capacity to rule. Like earlier sultans, the Khiljis and the Tughlaq monarchs appointed military commanders as governors of territories of varying size. So the military commanders were often slaves. So these slaves were appointed as governors of territories. These lands to which these governors were appointed, these lands were called Iktas. And the governors themselves were called the Iktadars or the Muktis. So there were two terms which were used interchangeably for the governors, the Iktadar or the Mukti. The duty of the Muktis was to lead military campaigns and maintain law and order in their own province, in their own Iktas. In exchange for their military services, the Muktis collected the revenue of their assignment as salary. They also paid their soldiers from these revenues. So, in exchange for their military services, the Muktis, the Iktadars, they collected the revenues of their assignments as salaries. So, the revenue they got from their province, that was their salary. And the soldiers who were under these Muktis, under these Iktadars, they were also paid from this salary. Control over these Muktis was most effective if their office was not inheritable and if they were assigned Iktas for a short period of time before being shifted. So the Delhi Sultans discovered that controlling these Muktis was more easier if their offices, their administrative posts were not hereditary, which means their son cannot be guaranteed as getting the father's post. Also, if they were assigned to a province for a short period of time, for like 1 year or two years, and then shifted to another province. These harsh conditions of services were rigorously imposed during the reigns of Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Accountants were appointed by the state to check the amount of revenue collected by the Muktis. Care was taken that the Mukti collected only the taxes prescribed by the state and not more than that, and that he kept the required number of soldiers and not less or more than that. So, the Sultan had his eyes over his Muktis. Care was taken that the Muktis were not misusing their freedom, and they collected the taxes which were prescribed by the state and not more than that, not for any personal use, and also keeping the required number of soldiers only and not more than the required number or less than the required number. So this was the administrative and consolidative aspects of the Delhi Sultanate. I think I am going to stop here for today. We'll meet again in the next video. Till then, bye.